isolation and non-linearity of time squarely seat him as a predecessor to theoretical frameworks that would become popular in Caribbean theory and literature in the 70s and 80s. Harris's primary topic is the imagination. Speaking on Haitian Voodoo, for example, he argues that it breaks the tribal monolith of the past and reassembles on intertribal or cross-cultural community of families, and to invoke at the same time a curious psychic reassembly of the parts of the dead god or gods, and that reassembly issued from a state of cramp to articulate a new growth. He also writes, fiction possesses a revisionary capacity itself, as if the text possesses an intentionality of its own to uncover connections that lie in other and deeper layers of what appears to be lost, areas that can be recovered to assist us in reading reality in a new way. It really must be asked why Harris is so unread. Ironically, he's so unread for the same reason that despite all of his problems, I always come back to him. The dense, sticky music of his prose. It's the most abstract thing ever.
I led many expeditions into the heartland of the Guyanas, and one of the things that struck me was that many members of the crew were oblivious of the great voyages that had occurred, that had, in a sense, deposited them in the Americas. The voyage has immense value because the voyage has within it something, I would say, that is divine. The voyage is always an exploration, it's a seeking, it's a searching, it's a quest for value. Now that quest may be overlaid by all sorts of matters to do with greed and loss and violence, but under that, that value remains. Lenko is really an African god. But one notes that he has a lame leg. So he's vulnerable. On the other hand, he's a god. He's divine. Now this is nothing new. One sees it with the Christian faith. Christ, the crucified Christ, is vulnerable, yet the Son of God. So we have Lenko, vulnerable, yet divine. And on top of that, Coffee, who is the rebel, the black rebel who fought in South America. That complex of forces is obviously a complex that is explosive. which we move are oriented to the wrong trend, the wrong wind, the wrong tide, whether we have to turn and go in a different direction, completely different direction. The questions we have to ask ourselves about nature. Nature ails. If one looks, for example, at the fantastic films of outer space, which are simulated, what do you see? You see meteors striking planets, gouging out great bits of planets, causing explosions as if those planets are vomiting, they're ill. There is an ailment running through nature, and we have to see that all of us, in some degree, have caught the virus.
I have been shot, a bullet in my back, I fell.
Where did you fall?
I fell from a great height into a painting in a gallery in a great city. I found myself returning across centuries and generations to the end of my age. I'd been caught by the artist in what seemed the womb of unexpected being in which one becomes sensitive to the end one has reached.
It was an end, it wasn't a beginning. One was called upon to probe and discover. We may dream while still alive of dying. But the dream is soon forgotten, as are the edges and corners of a relived life of which we dream. It's buried in the unconscious.
This is a form of entanglement. At such times of gravity, when one is a stranger in a great city, one is visited by troubling archetypal dreams.
Archetypal dreams deploy symbols of brokenness to depict the shedding of habit. A naked jar sings in a hollow body. Sings to be restored. The jar is adorned with the elusive faces of forgotten gods, the unvenerated dead, and those yet to come. The faces shuttered with mysterious curse. It may be that we are twins in a soul family, that I'm your twin in another universe, that our actions braid together on a wingless flight indexed in the unaccountability of stars like the silence war of ancient engine.
In my family, the counting of stars is forbidden as it brings words.
In mine, we would count the stars in secret and swore never to say the number for fear of being caught when the sun rolls into the sky, burning wind punished our land, searing the world like guts the earth wrenched, open slowly, swallowing our tin houses.
It may be that we are two parts of an unknown whole, a memory of the future etched into the stark landscape of world theater, its apocalogics calling for a brighter worship of unknown space, as well as language, the doubler twin of space. The true character of cosmic freedom is obscure. Yet that obscurity or darkness may bring to imaginative fiction and poetry a luminous paradox, depth and tone within the frailty of the human person in the backcloth, yet live tapestry of the universe that is appearing to the mind of science.
A universe of black holes, of neutrinos, of nameless entities, named quarks by Joycean scientists, a yet is so elusive. In essence, it resists conscription, it matches itself by subtle fissures of illumination within the prison house of existence.
There is a vertigo and anxiety to knowing that our actions impact each other's lives across universes. We may be intrinsically yoked by the nature of this meeting point. An ashen coconut covered in eggshell powder shone brightly to guide me here. To a door whose opening is closing, a fragile hinge of light, an offering to the unthought, which empties out the holy. A bright shadow peeks through, penetrates everything.
The subtlety of such illumination inevitably reaches forward and backward into the distance of time, into futurity, as dimension and complex dimension that seems objective yet confesses to the anthropomorphic elements in creature and creator woven into the living imagination to make an intuitive leap to come abreast as in a dream of the secrets of potentiality.
The secrets do suggest immaterial and untamable foundations for cosmos, or to a universe composed of fabrics of mobility akin to thought.
Further, as we know, our grasp of time tends to be incorporate tragic proportions or determined futures, and to overlook unspectacular resources of fluidity and imagination, that is to say, the reality of tradition that bears upon cross-cultural capacity for genuine change in our communities beset by complex dangers in whose antecedents are diverse.
And perhaps somewhere along the line of life in creation's hand that shaped Adam out of fabulous mud, life has prophesied its coming in hieroglyphic atmospheres, metamorphic vehicles and sculptures drawn upon sky and earth into a museum of gods, until vehicle or constellation became an obsession in wake or arousal of the human imagination, and the nail of space invited a further hammer.
Yes, to see anew, with shattered yet curiously liberated eyes, the border on alchemies of image and word, that see the curiously live new faces in the rocks and in the ocean murmur of trees. Sometimes we threw stones at the trees and they would throw them back.
Exile becomes the grounds of live fossil and sensuous memory within our legacies, which in our unmoored state we read as doomed falsely. These legacies of transplantation, of ancestral and forced migration, are threaded into our uncertain roots and into the unconscious of Caribbean poetry. With its correspondence across certain African, indigenous, Asian, and European legacies as intuitive layers of self, not a picture of the world or toolbox for dry use.
We must not let our always already becoming nature lapse into static, misgiving retreat, hollow moralizing in an astonishing underestimation of our complex and demanding arts. When you and I say intuitive layers of self, we mean a darkened psychic concentration that so pulls itself. It becomes an interior mirror reflecting the rain of flowers. It loses the biased rituals of material property in favor of kinship with immaterial images that cease to be passive or submerged. Each confesses to textures which make real a universe that can never be taken for granted as dead matter, as well as an organ of wholeness that is nevertheless at the heart of creation.
It happens so unpredictably, the rain of flowers, that it changed the planet and made the wound of self in nothingness. The sleep of being, the mystery in the void, or depth of pain to which we have no answer, only silence all the while getting faster.
Does the serpent feel pain? Does the fish feel pain as it slides and bounces again at a stone with a hook in its mouth, like a pre-Columbian baby astronaut on the moon? intrigued lovers across the ages. It was startled and shaken into profoundness, night-lost memories of pre-Columbian and African arts. I carried myself. Was I not living work of art, living flesh at the void of ineffable distance between creator and created? Scintillating like a fairy glass in a not time, in the void of time and timelessness? Was I not living flesh and living blood, which is proof of revolt of our characters, of our charismatic eternity, proof of another shape to time?
I was driven in my play, like you, to reflect on myself as an extinct creature. I dreamt I had been robbed of my everything. Both on this American mainland and the African mainland, I suffered a void of memory. I'd want the peoples of the void, but there was a catch, a shock of breath or breeze in the sensation. The shock of the peopling of the void, the flora and the fauna of the void, its climates and evolutionary paths, this shock became so extraordinary that extinction infused into me with breath lines and responsibilities I would not have otherwise encompassed. I became an original apparition, and in my wanderings as ghosts,
my shell, mechanical fungus.
But my ghetto is animal found toast. I came abreast of my extremities of loss and visualizing my own nothingness as intangible somethingness, my inhuman as human. In this way, memory theater was born, and I understood in a language of prayer something hidden, incalculable, formless. I understood the infinite rehearsal of quantity, the never arriving soul at the centerless center of things.
You were the fetus revived. You were the unborn grandchild revised, entangled in the waters of mirror, death revised in the unconscious fluid. I knew what my mother knew.
You knew.
I shared with her.
You did.
In a kind of void, yet potent, revisionary abstraction, her concerns, her anxieties. The postman's knocking, bringing letters from her grandmother's grandmother, from timeless, starless,
I must speak to you gravely within the implicit theater of fire, which is this church. I can look up at the skylight of space, of the sun which, like its ocean, is memory, and I can point and say, we stand beneath the phenomenon of the resurrection.
We resurrect ourselves, we understand.
We stand beneath the reverse pieta, the baby Christ holding her dead mother, and all the ghosts we have seen in the factory of the moon are our soul's technology, which speaks to us on a fragile hinge of light, in a uniform or fluid tongue to mimic seamlessness, as in the voice of God, an impossible ritualism of spirit that opens to broken hidden tongues in perennial war. When I come upon a fell tree in a park in England, it sometimes shakes itself in my inner eye as epitaph of a murdered forest in Brazil, or Benin, or Venezuela. I seek as if imbued by Lazarus, or like this mind, in my mind, to recrop that tree with the dissonant music of consciousness. With rustling, whispering branches in the foliage, it has lost the negative harmony of its broken roots to reclock, to quicken the soul in its timeless void, to know.
To know bottomlessly?
To know at the rootless root, as we knew before birth.
As we knew after death.
That the universe is the mind of God, and God, she is sick, tormented, if we choose to heal her,